Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, February 14th. Everybody have their Valentine's today?
Sure.
I only see one in the room. Happy Valentine's Day. Ask everyone to please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. Did you want to be my next? Thank you. I'll be your Clarence, you're here.
My wife was very kind of tried to sweep me up.
I will entertain a motion to approve the payroll warrant for 211, expense warrant for 214, withholding warrant for 117, expense warrant for 22, and expense warrant for 27.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Entertain a motion to approve the selected minutes for 318, 15, 10, 18, 16, executive session 11-1-16, meeting 1, 11-1-16, meeting 2, 11-15-17, and 12-13-16. That should be 11-15-16.
Yeah, 16. I just noticed that.
Yeah, that should be right.
Okay, I will make that motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Entertain a motion to acknowledge the fire department's report for 2017, emergency squad report for January 17, advisory committee committee minutes for 524, 6-1, 6-10, 6-15 of all 2016.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Announcements? First announcement, I need glasses.
Yes, you do.
Brookfield Adena Archaeology Project kickoff on Wednesday, February 15th, which is tomorrow at 6 p.m. in the Town Hall. Eric Johnson, UMass Director of Archaeology Projects, will provide an overview of the project. Brookfield and the area of the Quabog has a rich history as a trading route dating back at least 3,000 years. All are welcome. Please contact Mr. Snyder at 508-637-1377 for additional details. Woodland Management Program. Opakum Land Trust is holding a program Thursday, February 16th at 6:30 p.m. at the Brookfield Congregational Church, 8 Common Street, Brookfield. Program will include several landowners who are actively managing their forests as ambassadors, along with a representative of the DCR Forest Stewardship Program. For questions, please contact Mr. Hood at 413-477-1061. Tyler Wallen, District 8 to Senator Ann Gobey, will be holding office hours at the Brookfield Town Hall from 2 to 3 p.m. Tuesday, February 28th. All are welcome. Any other announcements? Anybody wish to address the board this evening? Welcome, sir.
Got a couple things to over the last few meetings. We had snowstorms, so we didn't meet a couple times. First one, you talked about, well, Clarence did, talked about not plowing private roads, so I'm going to weigh in on that. We shouldn't even be discussing that. Private roads are in every town. The only reason that it's a private road is it doesn't meet the standards of our other roads. And the people are still paying taxes, and they get nothing else besides, they get nothing. They don't get water, they don't get curbside. They get a lot of aggravation from the highway department trying not to do the job. So I think by even discussing this or trying not to plow private roads is a waste of our time.
I don't see it on the agenda, so I think it's moot.
It's not moot. This is my time.
Right.
Public access.
Well, you're pointing,
I'm a citizen.
You're pointing to the agenda, so.
I'm not pointing to any agenda.
My
the agenda's
fault.
Over there. Right. This is my agenda.
Continue, sir.
Okay, don't interrupt me. So anyway, getting back to the private roads, we went through this back, I think, 09, and we went through this before. So keep plowing the private roads. We shouldn't even be discussing that. So that's why I'm weighing in on that. Who took the signs down on Quabog Street for the bridge? Did we end up doing it, or did the state come in and do it?
They're gone.
Who took them down?
I believe we did.
Yeah,
I believe the state was down there taking them down.
Well, that's good
too. I saw Herb down there. He was taking them.
The state indicated that we should take it.
Okay, I saw the state taking the signs down, so.
I believe they were their signs that we bought.
Were their signs.
Well, my point, I guess the point I'm making is it got done, and we should have done it, and, you know, the state had to come in and do it for us. So once again, we dropped the ball, so. So that's what I'm saying. I gave the advisory board your procedure.
Oh, good.
And they weren't too keen on it because the policies and procedures in that book haven't even been followed from the get-go.
Very good.
Right from the get-go.
Very good observation. We'll chat about that later.
Yeah, we will. But I'm saying my point is having policies and procedures are not being enforced. And no one even looks at these things. So you could have a stack of policies and procedures on your table, Clarence, but it means nothing.
That's correct.
So trying to say to give someone something and make them sign for it and say, hey.
Without training.
So, well, everyone, what happened with the fire vehicle, everybody knows you got to come. The first thing was supposed to be done was a person should have come and seen you three to tell you what is going to take place. So is that in the policy? No.
Interestingly enough, you're correct.
It's not in the policy book. Right.
That's correct. We'll talk about that because it is on the agenda this evening.
So I'm just letting you know that.
Excellent observation.
And you also know, you had another time you were talking about figures that you got from the state.
Yes.
Compared to other towns and other states.
Yep.
Okay. We discussed that too, and you can't really do that because that's just a random figures.
But it gives you a place to start.
Not really, because each town does things differently.
True.
And I think by that factor, you're just gonna run different departments in each town differently, and you're gonna run one town against the other. It don't work.
Can I address that? Because I think it's an excellent observation. What that provided for me, David, was on one end, the elementary school was spending a lot less. When we're talking 10% less. That sounds like we ought to look to see why we might be different. As well as now the highway was
105.
Yeah, it was 100 grand less than the peers. Right. Is there something that drives that? So
the figures aren't correct. So how are you going to drive in anywhere? It's not correct figures.
So, okay. Again, observation from the advisory that in fact those numbers, the numbers that were reported for Brookfield were wrong.
They're generic figures.
They're
generic figures from other towns. You're just comparing a bunch of towns and you're coming out with figures. You can't do that. If you want to talk about the highway being under, I think we're over 105,000 the way we do things down there. And then some, not under.
But what the government reported isn't correct for the town. The town's numbers weren't.
What I'm saying, I don't know where they came from, the government, the state, the feds, but whatever, it's generic figures.
So
and you can't get an accurate figure by doing that.
Okay, and again, back to, I understand that to be a watchdog organization that reported government figures as to what we should have reported for what we were spending.
Mm-hmm.
If you're telling me that we're not spending those numbers, I'm a little concerned.
I'm telling you that those numbers are not accurate for this town. That's what I'm saying to you.
The comparison is not accurate, or the numbers aren't accurate?
Both, if I was to say.
I'm going to go look. Is that the?
Yeah, I'd like you to do that and break it down to me. But you can't take and can't compare this town and that town and this and that and say, oh, we're not doing as good as they are. Can't do it.
Well, again, maybe for
it's generic.
I agree. I'm not saying so. Don't disagree. What for the audience? What it was is it was a government watchdog organization that gathered information from the various towns by departments. And what it did then is compare. We're in the lower third of the Commonwealth as far as our population and geography, and so it reported what we spent. I believe what we spent for those breakdowns, and then it compared to similar towns. And again, I provided it as a guide to you to see, did it make sense? And what you're reporting is it doesn't make sense necessarily.
No.
And so we
definitely
need to look at it a little harder.
Yeah, because it's generic, you just can't throw a bunch of figures in there and come out, Brookfield is under on this and over on that, it's, can't do it. You can get an average or something, that's fine, but it's not going to really be an accurate figure.
Well, it helps us understand how other towns might be doing it better.
Well, you can do that, but you can't throw figures in there.
Well, and again, I believe it's used to be other towns' numbers.
Yeah, okay.
Our town.
All right, one other thing, how much longer are we going to be deciding on, just making a decision on my sign out here? That is a question.
I'm skeptical of answering because I have an issue. Linda was supposed to be the go-to person for that. Clarence got involved, which he wanted to back out, he even recused himself from the vote, but he's been corresponding with Michelle. But Karen, her decision, I guess I would talk to Clarence, I guess.
Yeah, where I see it is, David has a full responsibility of his sign. He has First Amendment rights, absolutely.
We haven't gotten the decision back from Michelle that we can release. But I think the plan was for next.
Yes.
For next week?
Yes,
okay.
For next week.
Yeah.
Well, she has some typos and whatever.
You wanted her cleaned up and rearranged.
Yeah. But no, I mean, you have your right to your sign.
Well, we knew that way back when. I don't think that's the question here.
I thought the question was about the sign.
Well, it's about the sign, but...
So now, what we need now need to talk about is the fine line of what I said and what I believe and what you believe.
Okay.
And we need to talk about it. There are two sides to the coin.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can't bring the sign into the town hall or the town hall to the sign.
But there are times that you
can't
are.
Do that.
There are times that you are a private citizen.
Well, let's hold
well,
on.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, we'll hold off on that too.
You'll have the right to enter an executive session.
I'll do it in open session.
Yeah, I think it.
I'll do it in open session.
Yeah, I agree.
But you're gonna have because I keep hearing next week. Next week.
We'll place it on the agenda for next week.
Right.
And you in open format right now don't want an executive session. You're waiving your right to that.
That's correct. I already told Karen that 10 times.
Well, you got to tell the chair. So we'll place it on the agenda as an item as opposed to an executive session.
Okay, so you're going to bring it.
And as policies that might need to be fixed, other things might need to be fixed.
Well, there's a lot of things that can be fixed.
Yeah.
But you know what? We can fix all these policies and procedures, but nobody follows nothing. Nobody even comes to you people.
Yeah.
You're back to square one. To what, you know? Okay. I said my little piece.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Welcome, sir.
Steve, can I wait when you get up to the snow and ice? Could I weigh in on that?
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Good evening.
Evening, sir.
Curious as to the lack of the subject of the fire chief reinstatement as far as the agenda tonight is. Can you give us an update on where that stands?
The accountant met with the suspended fire chief yesterday. I spoke with the accountant today. She's going to draft a report, turn it over to the selectmen, see what that is, and then hopefully deal with it next week at next week's meeting.
Okay. We had a major fire last night, and it was... just made it more apparent that something that needed to be dealt with very quickly, so.
Where was the major fire last night?
I'm sorry?
Where was the fire last night?
House fire on Lake Road.
Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? All right, as a request, I'm going to take the agenda out of order and bring number 4 up for discussion. Mr. Jones, welcome, sir.
Ah,
a new maintenance guy.
So, as everyone on this board is aware, the heater for the hallway and kind of vents up to the second floor that we just replaced with gas has cracked.
Steve, do you want me to kind of go through? I get the whole.
Go for it.
Yeah.
The floor is yours.
Okay,
sir.
So we started with a. There was a furnace. There's two furnaces in this facility. One is forced hot water that does the whole first floor except the lobby. The other one is a forced hot air system that was designed for the second floor and the front lobby. At some point, a decision was made, I don't know who made it or what, to convert from oil to gas. When the conversion occurred, when they were done with the conversion, they realized the old furnace was cracked.
Yeah, the heat exchanger.
Yep, nothing that anybody did had nothing to do with the conversion, it just never got discovered until it was converted. So at that point, now we have a dead furnace because we had already pulled out the guts of the old one. So the biggest, I talked to, I think I sent emails to everybody, and then Steve was kind of helping me along as to who to talk to. We called several people. The first one, they forwarded to some kind of a voicemail and never heard anything back from them.
Oh, these are separate packets?
Next one, ladies promised to have somebody get back to me, she never did. I don't want to say names and get anybody in trouble. The guy that had been doing the work had probably had a proposal to do a smaller forced hot air system just for the front hall. Steve, you had talked to him, and I haven't heard anything since you talked to him. What happened with that?
I stated that the board had to discuss it, that I couldn't make any decisions.
I didn't go forward pursuing anything from him.
I'm just going to stop there because obviously there's a bigger issue that.
Yep. Nope. I had a guy in Allen Plumbing, and he did the he does East Brookfield and Spencer's work. Did the furnaces in the town of Spencer, the town hall. I think they have four or five. He said now, because the days of having one giant unit are gone. Mm-hmm. You go with multiple smaller ones if you have a problem. You can take one out. It's a lot. It's to replace what we have exactly down there is a tens of thousands of dollars for a big commercial unit. He was not comfortable even giving us a bid after looking at it because he said, you really need an engineer here to figure out what your loads are and what you want. That brings us to McDonald's, who is the one person who actually came in with a quote. It was emailed to you today. I have not gone through the whole thing. I can tell you that it doesn't include grill covers. It doesn't include electrical. And the period grills are like $300 a piece. It's based on keeping the front hall at 68 degrees. As it keeps that at 68, whatever residual would go upstairs. Ultimately, if you had it where you thought you could use upstairs, it would be designed to keep upstairs at 60, provided there's some insulation up there. That's called twin furnaces. There's two furnaces that they work together. That would be a 96% efficient compared to 60 to 70 efficient, which was the old one. New thermostat, gets rid of the old furnace. Maybe, depending on what they run into, there might be extra cost there. The option two that he had was, he didn't put it in there, I don't believe, but take a hot water feed and run radiators out here. Get some old-fashioned radiators and put them in the front hall on a separate zone. And then when Tantasco showed up today, Scott Mansfield and the boys, we were kicking around some different ideas, and I knew that you would not be a fan of some gaudy electric baseboard heater. So we were talking, and I looked at the kids, some of whom I've coached, and I said, come on, boys, out of the box, what do we got here? And so they didn't say anything. And about 4 minutes later, one of the kids came over and said, what if we just put an electric blower, hot air, like furnace type thing, inside the existing air return and gave enough heat to at least cut the edge off that. So that the problem you have with this whole project is if we called in 10 people, you would have 10 quotes that you can't compare.
Because we have no comparison.
Because we have no direction. We have no idea what we want. We're just crossing our fingers that nothing freezes. I come in the morning. Most of the time, that office stays about 50 degrees right there now.
The good thing is that the bathroom upstairs is off the other one, and it's hotter than heck up there. So
that one, but there's plumbing in the hallway upstairs that is not heated. So I'd love to be able to say, here's three quotes, here's all apples, you can compare them, blah, blah, blah. I don't have anything, and I don't know where to go with it, and I feel like I've been spinning my wheels for a week and a half.
I disagree. You opened our eyes to the fact that we have to have plans for the building. Bringing Scott in, got the estimate, $1,100 would get that heater in that grate and give us temporary for the next couple of months when we're not going to freeze. That's a Band-Aid.
It is, because you're taking over, you're putting it in an air return.
Yeah.
So...
But it would supply us heat.
Yep. Just for down here, it doesn't do anything, there was residual heat going upstairs, there's nothing now.
Versus a $1,300-$1,400 expenditure that we don't have money for.
$13,000, $14,000.
Thousand.
Sorry, I say 100, was optimistic. We need to decide what we're going to do with this building. My thought is that through that non-binding vote at the town meeting, that the town wanted us to move forward with renovating this. I think we have to, as far as we're concerned, we have a plan in place, we've talked about this for years. We might want to put together an RFQ, or an RFP, whatever we're calling it, for an exact system that's going to feed what we need to feed. And if that requires revamping the forced hot water, and going with hot air for everything, or going with hot water for everything, I think that's the path we need to go down.
I think it's something that needs to be discussed. I would not be in favor of putting forced hot water upstairs, because down the line, if you ever did want to shut it down, you can't. Forced hot air, there's no water in the lines. You could put a split system up there, and it would run off whatever down here, the furnace would be in the basement, and then it would just have a heat, have a forced hot air come off.
You have ductless mini splits.
Yeah, you got all kinds of things, all kinds of options, but I would stay away from water in a building like this.
So do you know if there's any grants out there that would provide us with a study on heating this building?
Right off the top, I don't.
Is that something you want to look into, or?
I...
Am I wrong? Should we not pursue a plan?
Well, yeah.
We have to. The way I feel, we have to pursue a plan, because I mean, the upstairs right now, from not heating it, you know, a few years ago, the upstairs is a mess.
It's a mess.
And we can't, it's going to get worse.
There was paint falling off the walls and landing like...
Sheriff's Department's been about a decade.
When we were up there the other day, though, I mean, just because it's so cold now, it's colder than it's ever been.
And plus, we have records up there now, too, that were brought down from the third floor, we've got to consider doing something with those records, because they're just up there, and a lot of them...
But not only for that sake, but for the long-term plan of this building.
Yeah, we have to do something.
So it's enough of, I mean, we've been talking about the elevator for a very long time, and it's a $1 million deal, right? This really says you either use this floor or you expand.
Yeah.
What this is saying is forcing that design, which is now, it's going to be $20,000.
Sure.
I mean, if this quote is for 13 with all the unsundries with electrical and all the rest, you're talking close to $20,000.
Well, hopefully with electrical, we can have Tantasco do it, that's what I...
But just generally, I mean, so it's something that has to go before the voters.
But like Al's saying, and we learned real quick last week, that we need a plan that companies can compare apples to apples. You can't have each guy coming in and saying, I can do this, I should do that, we should do that.
Yeah.
We need a plan, so where do we get that plan?
Now, I've heard, and I've been here for a year, and I hear reference to all these studies that have been done on this building over the years. Did anything ever get studied about that in some of those other studies?
I don't think the heat, no.
I don't think the heat was ever brought into it at all.
The discussion was brought into the fact that we couldn't insulate upstairs, and that the windows were single pane.
Mm-hmm, which every contractor I brought through, that was the first thing they said. They said, oh, boy.
And they need that in their heat loss analysis.
Yep, exactly right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And it really gets to, this is a chunk that you'd have to spend if you're going to go upstairs.
So I guess my recommendation, and feel free to speak, get heat into this building. Scott was going to pull the trigger today. I had to talk him off the cliff.
That's why I sent you an email, because I didn't know where he went. I didn't want to be on the hook for that.
He was down the street, ready to buy the equipment.
I didn't give him any authorization or anything.
Neither did we, so I said, we need to bring this up tonight. It was conveniently, it was tonight that we met. My recommendation is pull the trigger on the blower in the hall to get heat in that hallway and opening the doors for it. Having you find out if we have any grants.
I'll work, yeah, sure.
Now, another question that I have, too, we've moved the historical commissioner upstairs. Now, with no heat on anything that they have up there, can I, you know, do something to all the old records that they have?
Al and I looked at it, worst case scenario, if someone came, if Ms. Plum came and said we need heat in there, open that bathroom door and we can heat it.
Yeah, it was open, and I closed it most of the way.
And the Board of Health office, I...
They have their own heat set up.
She has her own heat up there, comes from downstairs.
Yep, oh, she's nice and comfy, not to worry.
So it's just you?
Yes, as well as...
Well, he was nice and comfy when I came in last week, he had a space heater or something in there.
Well, no, it depends on what, if the door, front door's open, then the cold air flows right in. Which is, brings me to point number two, if we're done with point number one.
Yes.
The door was shut, was open more than it was shut yesterday. The wind blows that thing, it was wide open.
That's been going on out for years.
Once...
But the money that's going out the door right there, literally, is crazy.
We've had the company that installed it come in, they can't fix it. We've had Tantasco look at it, they can't fix it.
I was tempted to lock it yesterday and tell everybody use the ramp.
To be honest with you, I'd almost recommend taking off that opener, because that's where the problem began, was that opener. The push button.
So, which brings up point number two.
So can we finish point one first? So I'm gonna entertain a motion to allow Tantasco to install a heater in the ductwork at a price of $1,135.
I'll make the motion.
A second.
Any discussion?
Now, what we're saying though, this is just a Band-Aid.
Temporary fix.
And we're gonna do something so we can...
We have to do something, which Clarence has volunteered to look into, it's all money.
Yeah, we're gonna see if we can get somebody to do a study.
Okay.
To heat front and above.
Well, worst case scenario is we have McDonald's come back in, show them, meet with them, show them the plans of what we wanna do.
Yep.
Have them work up a...
Well, that's kinda what we did.
You look at the plans.
But he doesn't, you know, we've estimated volumes and things like that, but I'm thinking, if it's a grant thing, we must have all the square footage, the heights, I mean, all of that stuff, I would think.
Yes.
Rather than have to have somebody come in and reinvent the wheel, say, here you go, this is what was done.
You gotta tell them what you want.
Mm-hmm.
The study's there, what the study of the building and the progression of the four phases and all that, what it never talked about was a replacement of a furnace. Because it didn't think that it needed to do.
Well, and I think you need to determine, is 62 upstairs adequate? So that it's, if the thing cranks, then that's what you're gonna get.
As far as I'm concerned.
So the worst day of the year, it's gonna be 62.
It should be adjustable, and I think it should be hotter than 62 if we plan on using it.
If you ever get up there.
Well, I don't know, I mean, how many months out of the year, you know, would that be a problem? I mean, that would be a worst case, I don't know. That's the kind of things that, that's the first thing they're gonna ask.
Let's see where the study can come in.
Let's go see if we get a grant.
And I have another question to ask. The gentleman who was just working on the furnace recently, I happened to notice today, I was going through things, you know, before the meeting this morning, and that gentleman had given us some kind of an estimate back last spring.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Didn't he know that there was a crack in it last spring?
Because it wasn't cracked.
It wasn't.
Well, we don't know. It could have been. If nobody had tried to tune it up, you would never know.
So it's
so, I mean, when he was down there looking at it last spring, he didn't notice there was a crack in it?
He doesn't service the equipment.
Oh, he...
What he found was when he did his carbon monoxide, he found the carryover. And then it was, where's the carryover coming from? And it's coming from a heat exchanger that failed. And so he would have never, when he came in. This is changing the burner is one thing, and that's what he quoted.
Okay.
And he's thinking, I'm gonna put this burner in and everything's gonna go fine. And when he did his testing, it didn't go fine. And we're putting carbon monoxide in this space, which is a bad thing.
That was my only question.
I know the rep from McDonald's said that he told somebody that he recommended against converting that to gas.
We got information that we could.
Yep, no, I'm just saying that he stated that. He didn't put it in his thing.
I don't think it was a conversion that did it, so.
No, I think it was done in advance of that. It was whatever damage, it could have been done for, it could have been like that for 2 years.
Oh, yes.
All right, so there's a motion on the floor, all in favor?
Yes.
All right, part two, the door, Clarence?
So we do have an opportunity to have Steve come in on a part-time basis to do some of the doors and sills and those kinds of things. And he was not available for a couple of weeks, but he could come and start working on the ADA kinds of things with the doors. And that would be like the first thing that I would think that he could jump onto as far as engineering the door and working the door.
That front door?
Yeah.
Do we have money?
Is he a good-sized gentleman, right? He was in last week, and we haven't seen him since.
Yeah.
Who was this?
I think one of the doors is warped, that's part of the problem. The right-hand door is warped, I believe.
Yeah, well, and again, he's a carpenter that knows something about doors. We have a shot of seeing if we can fix it.
Yeah, oh, definitely, I just haven't seen him come back.
Back to the opener, but he had a couple of weeks that he had projects ahead of him, but that would be available.
And that's why I was surprised that you said he was retired, I didn't think he retired, so.
Well, he's got, just like I'm retired, like, Steve, I'm retired, didn't you know that?
And Linda is as well.
They're all retired.
So was it a volunteer service, or?
That he would be working at his town rate. That would be.
Where would that money come from?
That would be coming out of our budget.
The Selectmen's expense, or?
For whatever.
Do we have any maintenance expenses?
So can you work with Karen to see if we have it, and I'm not opposed to it.
Yeah, right.
But we did talk about if I can get that mason in, Tantas was kind of dragging the feet because they have a couple of projects, and I think they see that as a spring project.
Yeah, we should, yeah.
But if we can get a mason, the whole ramp door hinges on restructuring that opening because it's too small, so the masonry has to be widened. If Steve wants to work on that too, I'm not opposed to it, it's gonna be cheaper, but obviously be cheaper with Tantas, but it would be quicker.
Well, some leadership with some experience, so yeah, two could go together.
If you wanna check with Steve, if he wants to contact me, totally up to you.
Well, sir, well, roll.
Yeah, and in the bathroom as well, if you have one, have them look at, the door has to be widened, and then petition for grab bars.
ADA first.
Well, that is ADA.
Yeah, well, yes, absolutely, yes.
But I still haven't lost sight of Tantas, I'm still trying to contact them all the time, it is what it is.
We'll take it away, yeah.
One more thing. I don't know enough about how everything's put together when it comes to the budget. Is there a maintenance budget? And is there like a 5-year plan? Like, the other furnace is going. It's going. It's not gone, but it's going. Is there any kind of foresight where we say, you know, we should really be planning on 8-10 grand for that one in another year? Is there anything like that?
That should be part of the committee that we're trying to get back together. Peter O'Connell's trying to put that back together.
I talked with Karen about that, yeah.
It is part of any 5-year plan. We don't have a 5-year plan.
Okay, that was my question. Yeah, it seemed like, as I look around, that might be helpful. Budget-wise, too,
but
I don't know.
At the same time, allocating money for that's tough. People don't want to bank money.
But then at least you tried. You know, that would be my...
I've been trying for the past 3 years because nobody wanted to serve in the CIPC. I've been trying to build that into the advisory committee's purview.
But we need another, how many members now?
It's on the agenda. We're going to talk about that later.
So I'm going to head out. I've taken up enough of the time. At this point, we don't need any more quotes. We don't need anything. Tantasco is going to handle the heat.
Temporary.
And the front door is going to be handled by, or at least he's going to look into it by Steve.
Good.
Right? Is that?
Hopefully he didn't walk away from it because he's disgruntled, doesn't know what to do about it. No. It's a tough nut. That's a tough door.
And he's willing to do it, to look into it.
God bless him.
Yeah. Mr. Jim,
thank you, sir. Yes.
Are we good?
Just as a comment to the heat, I think you're right, we need to figure out what your present needs are and what your future needs are, and use of that area. And I think you need a mechanical engineer to come in and tell you, do the heat loss calculation.
Well, that's part of
that would be
McDonald's. They'd have to do all that, but right. We could do it in advance and give that out as the RFQ or whatever we're calling it.
And so National Grid also has energy saving monies that's available. Now, I don't know if they're available to a community. I know they are to homeowners and businesses, but I don't know if it is the community. But you might look into that.
It might be because of the gas.
Well, they're the ones that have the energy saving programs, gas and electric.
But when you think of that, you just think of the lights where they come
in. But they do both. Because I converted electric heat in my house to split units, and I got a grant or a rebate. Also, manufacturers were giving pretty substantial grants or rebates.
That might be for homeowners, so because they're doing
it. It may be, but it's something that I know, like the Mitsubishi units, got almost a 50% rebate on the units themselves.
That's a tough
Maybe homeowners or businesses that may not qualify for community.
But with the ductless, the mini splits, you get into the issue of condensers outside and running.
Well, there are other kinds of units, but yes, they may also be covered. Just apply.
One other thing that they do is insulation. Is it something else that they handle? So maybe there's some other option there that has never been explored for upstairs.
Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.
Back to item number one, email, website discussion. Karen, this is your baby.
Okay, well, Dr. Chuck Tom George, she did get some quotes, and right now, I mean, we have a problem with email. What's happening is people, as you know, Clarence, I'm sure you know that your email box, it gets full, and oftentimes I have to call Mr. George, he has to up the email, which always costs more money. Mm-hmm. So this has been a problem ever since I came here 2 years ago. We've been talking about going, we're going to go with virtual town hall.
Yep.
We were told that it would be able to archive the emails, because that's what we want also.
We allocated money to town meeting.
Yes, yeah, and it's still in the budget, that's what we're going to use, hopefully. Well, we did find out that didn't include the archiving, so he went back to the drawing board, and this is what he came up with. Okay, right now, for a $2,000 one-time setup fee and a $4,250 yearly maintenance fee, and the reason it would cost so much is because we have 85 email accounts. It costs $50 per account. And we were thinking, some people with committees, they don't necessarily need to have a Brookfield account. They can use their personal account. So we might be able to reduce that number, hopefully.
That would be something maybe we could go through.
Yeah, that was my plan. I'm asking for a list. Yep. We have 85.
I would run that through town council, because of this serving and capacity of town business. You need that email trail.
Okay, but some committee members, you should know, do use their home email. So
it's probably people that are still on our email that aren't even with us anymore.
Deleted, yeah.
They've got to come up.
Yeah, we're going to get a list from Tom, see if we can cut down on that. But anyway, so that total cost is going to be $6,250. We do have that money in the budget, because it's for the email, because we did, as you say, funded it last year. All right, that's immediately how much it's going to cost. Year two and every year thereafter, if we keep the 85 accounts, it's going to cost the $4,250 every year just to keep up those accounts. That's how it is. That's how much it costs.
Which we can incorporate into the budget.
Right, okay.
But we could decrease that.
Right, we're going to try to decrease it. Now, for the website, I mean, I know it really isn't up to par. Everybody knows it's not up to par. I mean, we have a guy who practically volunteers, so I feel like, we can't ask him to be too creative. But if we switch everything over to an easy-to-use, more friendly website, we can have the municipal clerk, post things timely. We could have each department head post things. It would be so much easier.
Who would be the municipal clerk?
Well, it's Lois now. Well, it's Lonnie now filling for Lois, and Lois will come in once she recovers.
So it would be out of the hands of Tom?
Maintenance.
It eventually be out of the hands of Tom, not right away, because I think we need him for a while, just in case something goes wrong. But he's going to make it user-friendly, so each person can post their own items and delete their own items and keep it up to date.
Can I change the subject just for 30 seconds?
Not yet, because I'll lose my train of thought.
Nope, keep
no
going.
Offense to you. I'm not comfortable with everybody and their brother having access to the website.
So, my 30 seconds?
Okay.
So you have a veteran volunteer that we as a town have not had the opportunity of having a veteran volunteer for a very long time who has IT experience. So I'm wondering if that might be the volunteer activity that we could hook him into.
That would be great.
Because if you go to bcc1857.org, you can see the guy's work, and it's great.
Oh,
he just updated the church's website.
Oh, wow. Interesting. Okay. Now, as far as the website goes, again, there's a setup fee, $5,000, and then $1,750 yearly maintenance, which is due once the site goes live. So, again, we're going to need it's $6,250 now, which is in the budget. Then for fiscal year 18, $4,250 for the email, $6,750 for the website that includes that first year setup fee of the $5,000. So it's actually going to have to budget $10,900 for fiscal year 18 just to get everything in place. And then fiscal year 19 and thereafter until they go up, it's going to cost $5,900 to keep the email and the website going.
So the website would be applied until the budget's approved in June.
Right.
And it actually wouldn't start until July 1st.
Right. But the emails can start now.
I don't think we need a vote on this. I think the money's there, okay. Unless you want to take a vote on it to document it.
I think documentation.
Yeah.
So I will entertain a motion to allow Karen to enter into an agreement for the initial $2,000 one-time setup fee and the $4,250 yearly maintenance fee, with the ability to possibly go down because of deleted email accounts, with the current budget that we have.
I'll make that motion.
And I'll second.
Any discussion? In discussion, Karen, please make note that a new budget will have to be presented to the advisory committee for next year's budget in regards to this account.
They know that. That's what we have. Right
now. Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, Karen. Item number two, nail me to the cross, but I think I made a wise decision by allowing the highway superintendent the ability to go out for a transmission I believe it was Mac, that for a new transmission. He did receive two quotes. They were a little bit more expensive, but within reason, because piggybacking it, it was a better warranty.
Yeah, he called me up on it.
Okay.
Discussed it with me too.
Long story short, they actually sent the wrong transmission. If you guys heard that, but with the snow, I thought it was a wise choice, so I'm going to need a motion to ratify that.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Item number three, if anyone's noticing that it's icing or snowing pretty much every other day, and we're back into deficit again. Email, we currently are approximately $18,000 worth of salt, which has been delivered and not paid for yet. We have approximately $1,500 worth of sand delivered and not paid for. I estimate payroll so far to be $4,300. Total to date, $23,800. Please keep in mind that this number does not include any repairs or broken equipment. Recommendation for deficit spending would be $30,000. Dave, you wanted to weigh in on this?
Yeah, a little bit.
I noticed the new practice that the highway down there is doing, and we're seeing it come across the advisory board figures.
A new what, Dave? I didn't hear you.
I said the practice that they're using at the highway department, they're using a lot of sand, lot of salt now.
They started that last year or the year before.
Right, and it's three to four times more than sand.
Cindy explained that today because someone called and asked, and she said that the reason they're using more salt is because it's more efficient. It works faster, and they realized that Dawn actually went to a seminar where they had an efficiency for the salt and sand, and it's actually cheaper for them to use more salt and less sand, because when they use sand, they have to pay for the street sweeping for the employees, you know.
Well, to me, that's opportunity cost. I almost agree that we should go to a mixture because it is cheaper.
Well, but I think it should be looked into before we make any snap decisions here. And salt is 65 a ton, and I think our sand is 15 a ton, thereabouts.
She said it ends up coming up cheaper by trying to factor in the streets.
I disagree because of the opportunity cost. We're using company time to sweep streets.
Yeah.
We're going to sweep them anyway.
We're going to sweep them anyway.
You're going to sweep them anyway.
We have the machine.
And the other thing is, which is kind of mind-boggling to me, and a few other people have mentioned it to me, is, okay, we're not going to have any sand cleanup, so why are we going to go and buy this big fancy basin truck?
But we're not, because
it's
just the center of town that we're salting. The exterior of the town is still salt sand, so they are still sweeping.
Right. But I'm just saying, this salt, I mean, the price of this salt is not cheap.
I brought that up a couple of years ago.
It's pure. I mean, they're putting pure salt down. They're not mixing it at all.
Yeah, there's two. If you look in the highway barn, there's two sides, salt.
Yeah, it's mixed.
No, there's a side that's pure salt.
Oh, they're mixing it. They're not doing the whole entire town yet, but little, every year it's more and more and more that they're using pure salt. What I'm saying is I'm suggesting to you that you look, someone should look into the real facts of the cost of pure salt.
That's a fair question.
And look into it. Because, I mean, look.
But that's how Herb answered me a couple of years ago when it started coming up, that the opportunity cost of sweeping the streets outweighs the price for the salt up front, which, again, I disagree, but...
We're going to sweep the streets anyway.
I'm one of three.
What I will report is that someone did a little study of 20 towns, and we came out number two for yes. the last week's set of storms.
Number two.
What number two was far as...
As far as the effectiveness of our plowing operation.
Oh, yeah. I saw that, too.
I understand it, but if you peel that back and take a look and look how much material and how much labor we are doing to get to that point, it's phenomenal. So you have to figure that in as well.
So do we vote a budget at town meeting?
Correct.
Yes.
But that's where it needs to be brought up.
I think it does.
And I'm going to piggyback off this even further, is that our highway superintendent refuses to meet with the advisory committee. We need to make it pretty well, again, one of three, clear that they have to meet with the highway and with the advisory committee. Or else, in my opinion, they get level funded. And they have the discussion of the salt and sand versus having their opinion where they can question them. So do you want to have the advisory committee set a budget for the highway department, or do you want to have the highway department come in?
I think I did no news as far as them not meeting, so.
Well, they refuse to, from what I'm hearing.
Oh, yeah, I've read that. Would they come in and meet if one of the board of selectmen went in with them?
I don't think the board needs to be there. They have their own committee that they're charged to do a budget.
I meant would the highway come in if...
Why do we have to babysit him?
No. You three are his boss. If he says he's not coming in, that means the next person can say the same thing, and then it's going to spiral. And what's the sense of doing anything then? And I don't want to level fund anybody. I want someone to come in there and explain to the board why they're spending money and what the reason is, and not on the town floor. You know, should be at least discussed through the finance advisory board so we know what this money is, you know, what this money is in the budget for. And that's why these people, you know, department heads should come in.
So the highway department refused to give you a budget, their budget.
They refused to meet with the advisory board.
They gave you the budget, but they refused to meet.
Right.
So are there questions that you have relative to the budget you received?
Everything.
Well, that's... I mean, sure.
Going back and forth, this person through that person, no, it doesn't work. You get it, the person.
No. My question is, you received the budget. Are there pluses and minuses from past years that you question?
Yes, every budget is questioned every year, pluses and minuses. Every budget has pluses and every budget has minuses.
Are there things that stand out to you that are really egregious?
Every budget stands out, everything.
So every line on the highway department's budget that any they submitted line on, to you are all egregious.
That's correct. And the same with anyone else's budget. It's the same way. We analyze every budget, every line.
No. I'm not asking you that.
Oh.
My question is it egregious? Is there something that's so different from past practice or past years? I mean, sitting there and discussing something year over year over year that is traditional, I would say, you know, what are we talking about? If there are some things that are really... Mm-hmm.
Well,
deltas.
The figures are different.
The big delta here
the figures are different.
The ice.
Yeah.
So, there's a good question about snow and ice. Let's sit down and say, we've had a past recommendation from one side. Let's go, if that's what we're going to talk about, then let's go talk about it. But are we talking about the whole budget? I mean, I can't fathom.
Yeah, we're talking about the whole budget,
I can't fathom that.
And I just sat here and said that we should discuss the use of salt, the practice of using straight salt. I just said that when I came up here.
It's not a 100-line budget,
which is
Clarence. There's only a few line items on that budget, so.
Now, when you
it's a big budget.
money-wise.
It's 10% below or 100,000 below all average towns of about 6,000.
No. I'm going to argue that.
Are we in agreement? Are we in agreement that the highway department needs to meet with the advisory committee?
Yes, they have to. I feel.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, one question I have to ask Dave: when you send out your budget forms, do you have them itemize everything that they have to do? Like, I remember when I used to do budgets when I was town clerk, I used to have to put in so much, I would explain how much money I had I was going to use for education, how much I had to use for supplies, and down the line.
It's most of them are like that, yes. Yeah. Some break it down more than others.
And Carrie provided that form.
Stamps and...
Okay.
And you can...
Right.
So you still do it the same way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I would say we're doing it different this year than past because we added the column back in of what was requested over what will be recommended.
Well, I don't think that has been decided yet.
Well,
I think it should be.
Well, that's going to be the discussion when we get to the end. Right.
Yeah, but the data is going to be there to use. We're not going to dump it off the end.
No. I mean, the discussion and how we're going to do it is going to be at the end when we get to the end of the budgets.
What they did years ago, the money that they requested, that column was printed in the warrant.
Absolutely.
And I think it should be there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, like I said, we're going to discuss that.
Yeah. But I can't believe it's every line that's going to be in conflict.
Yeah.
Right. Now, the next question while I'm up here is when are one of you going to sit in periodically? In case, you know, a lot of the members would like to have one of you members sit come in periodically and sit in.
When you meet, I think we had the discussion last week, you can meet on a Monday. I think you do have Monday meetings. I can sit in on a few Monday meetings.
Okay. And the other...
I can't do Thursday.
If you see my week with my two meetings...
I could have come in probably occasionally for a Monday night meeting.
Yeah, Monday would be best for me, later in the month.
Okay.
So just give one of us a word. We're there.
Okay.
I
got something else that's kind of...
Well, let's... One second first. Yep. I'm going to entertain a motion to allow the highway department to deficit spend $30,000 in the snow and ice account.
I'll make that motion.
So what's that, make 40,000 over so far?
We did 10 last time, right?
Okay.
Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Dave?
You're talking about this elevator and talking about upstairs. I went to a few town halls and I checked with the state and they have a stair, a stair lift?
Yep. We looked at that.
And Warren, Mass has got one and it takes wheelchairs. And it takes quite, I forget what the weight load is.
Who has it, Warren?
Yeah.
Yeah, we looked at that.
So I'm saying if we can't get this elevator, I mean, this could be a possibility. It might be 35, 40 grand, might be 25, I don't know. What do you think about that? I figured I'd run that by you.
I'd say we have to ask people who are going to let us put a furnace in. And I don't think they're going to let us put a furnace in, David.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's a big question.
I don't think the furnace, you can't run the furnace against doing a stair lift. You're talking about an elevator.
I'm saying just putting 20 grand in front of the town meeting for a furnace for this place to heat the second story.
That's another thing. Before the plaster started to go up there, a certain selectman put a piece of plywood up on the grate up there, and it was just enough heat to keep that place nice up there.
It's still there.
It's still
right,
there.
And when that plywood was put there, that's when the upstairs started to go to hell. Mm-hmm. So if you just remove that plywood, it's like, it's just the excess heat coming from down here, it's going up into that grate.
Now the furnace isn't working.
But I understand it, but I'm just saying, if we want to get to save the building from crumbling anymore, if we just remove that piece of plywood, you have just like 50 degrees, 40 degrees.
As far as I'm concerned, Dave, we brought it to the meeting. They said fix it. If we design a system that heats the whole building and they shoot it down, I'm done with the town hall.
Yeah.
I am too.
I am too.
Well, that's my point. You should look into at least a stair lift. It's a lot cheaper in the town, and it will make us ADA.
Why bring people up there if we can't heat up there? If they shoot down the furnace, we're done. Why spin our wheels and have committees and have Clarence look for grants and do this and do that for years upstairs?
Well, let's see what...
There's been generations that have worked to get this building to where it should be. And if we're not going to go down the trail, then let's get off the trail and go do other things.
Well, let's see what they say first, but I'm just giving you this option so it can be out in the wings. But it is, if I don't know how many people are going to need it. I mean, if you want to get real fancy, put the elevator in if people want to go for it, or if you get a grant. But until then, this is a pretty good cheap option, because I check Warren's out pretty closely.
We've talked about that on multiple committees, and everyone said that we can't do it.
I know, and I do.
And I've never gotten a reason for it.
We asked the guy to give us that quote for the chair.
I think that will give us a quote.
Do you remember, Don, why we couldn't do it?
Huh? If I remember right, ADA said it didn't qualify as a means of ADA access. I don't know. Dave, do you know how old that chairlift is in Warren?
No. Yes, I do. I can't remember now. 15 years, maybe?
Probably doesn't qualify by today's standards, I'm guessing. But I don't know. It's been a number of years since
Didn't they just redo their town hall? Or was it the police station?
This is in their school.
That's the school at Shepherd. It's the Shepherd building.
Well, I mean, I checked with the company because she had the thing right there.
If
Warren.
It's with the school, they have to be compliant regardless of how grandfathered it was.
No, the town hall took over the old school over there in Warren. That's what
the old school is the town hall now.
That's the town hall.
And I checked with the town clerk and she gave me, I've talked to the guy. He's going to come down maybe in a week just to see if it can be done. But he said it is ADA
compliant.
Compliance.
Get a quote.
Yeah, get a quote from him.
I mean, it's something that, you know, if we don't do the elevator and we want to get up there, if we get the furnace fixed.
It's better. Yeah. It's cheaper. It's quicker.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, how many people are going to really use, you know.
How many people?
They say one person in Warren uses the lift.
Well, using it, but it allows us, it allows every citizen in Brookfield to use upstairs.
Right, right. Well, that's what I'm saying. It gives us permission to use the upstairs again.
Yeah.
As I recall, I think the current regulations are elevators in a public facility have to be big enough to handle a gurney in case there's an accident up there.
That's true.
And so if you have a chairlift, you can't, that's not going to solve that problem.
Well, I checked what they said it meets the ADA requirements of using the second floor. That's what they told me, so. And I checked with the company as well, and they said the same thing.
Yeah, I think Kermit's right. I think when we looked at the elevator here, we looked at three options. One was a regular elevator. One was a smaller elevator, which was less expensive. I think it's called the Lulu, which would not accept a gurney, and that didn't meet requirements. And I think it's the same reason that the chairlift wouldn't.
Chairlift and
probably make a quick call to ADA.
No, we'll get built to do it.
I've done it, but the elevator, yes, it has to take a gurney if you use an elevator, but this other thing is different. I'll get some facts and. Yeah, I'll get some facts and bring them in.
I would like to think that if we can get a cow up and down those stairs.
Yeah.
Which we literally did.
We did, Elsie the cow.
The men and women of Brookfield can get men and women on a gurney up and down those stairs, even a backboard.
All right, one other question. How much was the transmission? You didn't say. And if you did, I didn't hear it.
It wasn't in the packet. Was it like 5,000?
Yeah.
5,700?
56 or something like that.
This was how about 8,000? That sound good?
No.
Maybe 4?
No. It was around 5,000, Dave. Yes. This was a couple weeks ago.
So. How much?
57.
Okay.
It was the last I heard.
And that is that a price for the trainee, or is that a price yeah, including labor? Now, who's putting it in? And
we put it in, and it also included the clutch, if my memory is
correct. No, I think the clutch was more.
Was it more?
Yeah, because it was a different entity that was doing the clutch.
But we were doing it together. Yeah. So maybe the $8,000 is probably closer, if that.
I thought the clutch was like $1,200 or $1,400.
$1,800.
All right, I'll ask the highway then. Get a firm figure, you know.
Yeah, she knows.
We took a vote on the 30,000.
All right, thanks.
Item number 5, policies discussion. Clarence, the floor is yours.
Great. So I handed you some documents last week. And so we've, in the meantime, we've had an all-employee meeting as well, a department head meeting. And I went through what I'm about to go through with you, with them. And the last few weeks have been disappointing to me as far as communication and the frustration of people talking to people and being able to communicate with people. This policy and procedure document is a good document. It's a good first step, a start, and what needed to be done. And so I'm not criticizing the effort that went into this. Linda, I'm not criticizing the work that's going into the personnel handbook that you're about to disseminate or attempt to disseminate. But probably the first thing that you find when you go through this document is the first attachment. And you have an attachment that talks about an acknowledgement.
Yep.
Well-meaning people put this document out by email to the different departments. We don't have one of these documents back signed. We started with the session the other day of some training of what is in this document.
And I've heard what happened in that meeting. Every single person that was in that meeting was part of putting this document together.
Oh, and I
personally held four or five different group meetings. Everybody waited on this.
Yep. I'm not saying that did not happen. It happened. What I'm saying is we send a document out. There should have been, at the time that the document went out, there needed to be some training. That's all I'm making a point of. And at the conclusion of that training, that document should have been signed. As those individuals have received this document, they understand the document, and they acknowledge that.
Again, just devil's advocate, I'm not being defensive here.
No.
The majority of department heads work on that document, so they know about that document.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
The second piece of this, and Steve, looking at what should have been done didn't get done. There was back in 2011. Now I've lost it. Hang on a second. What's missing for me in this document is, you know what it is. It's a document that talked about having a review prior to the steps that are in this document. This is how I translate how this document should have incorporated this document, and it didn't. Are we in agreement?
50-50 is what it is.
Okay, all right, so the point was that this procedure that was put together at that time, had it been found here, and folks acknowledged the receipt of that, we might have averted some.
Again, we can't have that discussion tonight. And I'm not playing coy.
Exactly. So where I come is that I started the other day with the employee meeting to start to work through what I understand the process and procedure is, and we need to do more of that. What I would look to do at either the next meeting of the department heads or a subsequent meeting is that, in fact, the acknowledgement document in place.
I'm on record now, I've voiced it privately, extremely disappointed that didn't get signed.
Yep.
But at the same time, Mr. Holcraft, when he comes up here and he says, people are going to do what people are going to do, they knew that they had that in there. It keeps going back to Mr. Holcraft, the private roads. We have a policy to plow private roads. It's not this board or the highway department picking on people on private roads. We have policies in place. Part of that policy is returning a form.
Oh, absolutely.
They don't do it.
Karen has sent this out numerous times, I know.
Twice at least.
She sent it out to the departments and they haven't signed it.
So when I'm back
and
to...
Did you really, the thing too, like I mean, Steve said before about how we can't go in and babysit people to the advisory board, it's the same thing. I mean, you can't babysit them and tell them all they have to be signing these. They should
be
Well,
you can. You can be on top of them 24-7, but is that what we want to do?
Well, if we're looking...
Regardless if they sign it or not, we've obviously been told that they're not going to follow it, so on certain people.
So then we need to change the policy. Catch 22. And so what I'm recommending, and I'm volunteering and have volunteered, is that I'm going to take this procedure, take it to the next employee meeting. We're going to dig down further into the document, and I'll be asking for that sign-off. That we agree that that's how we're going to operate.
So if you're going to volunteer, I would recommend, recommend's a good word, that you would take that time and just, through Karen, state that we need a signed release. And that should alleviate a lot of your energy.
That we buy into the document, because it's a good document, good start, could have a couple of things added to it.
This is a living, working document that can be adapted at any point.
And it needs to be.
And for us to sit here and say we're not going to change anything in here is just ignorant.
Right.
And we voted, and then we voted on this, we pulled it up today, it was voted on June 1st, 2015.
The first thing you stuck me with. I mean, it was good, my first meeting. I love it.
And we voted, we signed off on it, so it was accepted.
Accepted by us, not necessarily by all.
But it went back and forth, though, Clarence, between all of, I remember it went back and forth with all the departments.
Linda sat in on multiple meetings as well. We had, I want to say, at least six meetings. Yeah. You know, Brenda, you never see Brenda in any meeting. Yeah. It was awesome to see Brenda from the library come over and voice an opinion on that document.
They were in, they were coming.
I was friggin' thrilled to see people that you didn't see in that room sharing a voice.
Yeah. And again, it's something that we need to work on. And back to that HR couple of hours that I'm talking about, that would be one of the projects ongoing of training and continuing to train.
That was another thing to piggyback on this. So if it's another, you had mentioned a couple meetings ago that HR piece that you wanted to add to the budget,
mm-hmm.
human resource within in-house.
Right.
I don't think you were here when we had it, but I think it was like $5,000 a month, a year.
$6,000.
So it's up to six.
Yeah, we talked about it.
Okay. Yeah. We used it, I think, for 2 years. Pat Cantor at that time recommended that we didn't because we weren't getting the money that was the return on investment we weren't getting, so we eliminated it.
Right. KMP to do it would not, it's not, that's not the place.
They have those seminars, they have the knowledge, they have...
This is working documents.
No, I'm talking about the HR.
Oh, yeah. Their level of HR...
We set policies. We can look to them for opinions on policies if have them, but I agree that policy's us, the onus is on us, but that HR piece was just piggybacking off the fact that KP has that availability if you want anything like that.
And where I was, I respect, totally respect that they have a practice and they do some things. This is working level.
That's two totally different
things. Two different things.
Yeah, I was just piggybacking because I just remember the HR.
Yeah,
things.
But if we were to have that $6,000 available to us to have someone provide that kind of training, it needs to be someone in-house that has some expertise.
But what better than a law firm where it has to... No, that's what HR is all about, is laws and ramifications due to the fact of violating them.
There's times for lawyers and there's times for not lawyers.
I get you. Yeah.
And I'm for that small government too.
100%.
All right.
But there's a reason for attorneys, unfortunately.
So, department heads, for a while, we're going to work on this. We're going to buy into it. Right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Item number six, appointments. Unfortunately, have we ever said this in a meeting before? We had too many members on the Zoning Board of Appeals. Or any committee, when we appointed Mr. Simon to be a true member. So I am going to ask for a motion to remove Mr. Simon, or rescind the vote from Mr. Simon as a member of the ZBA, and at the same time entertain a motion to appoint him as an alternate member of the ZBA, with the term to expire June 30th, 2022. Holy. Wow, I just felt old.
All right. Stop talking.
Yeah, I am.
I will make that motion.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Special use permit. One motion. So Karen, the reason why we're doing this, so many, Karen has...
Because they added up while I was away.
Karen's very nicely put into three packets, so it's palatable. So I'll entertain a motion to allow the Greater Lowell, and this is all one motion, Greater Lowell Bass Fishers, the use of Quabog Pond on 5/20/17, Mass Bass Alliance, Quabog Pond, 5/27/17, Quabog Pond, Mass Bass Alliance, 6/4/17, Quabog Pond, American Bass Anglers, District 36, 8/6/17, Quabog Pond Classic Bass Anglers, 8/13/17. Quabog Pond Big Bass Busters, 8/25/17. Quabog Pond ABAD 97, 8/27/17. Quabog Pond Cabin Fever Bass Club, 9/17/17.
Quabog Pond Shootout Series, 9/23/17.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, I have issue with number... This is out of order. Did I take it out completely? Nope, just out of order. Number eight, the CDBG documents, there's two of them in here that they're requesting. He's actually coming in next week. I don't know if we want to table this, but we have been working back and forth with him in regards to the wording of the first one. This all goes into grants, which I'm an advocate for.
Mm-hmm.
First one's for the Brookfield Senior Center. The way that it was worded before, basically established the basement as a current facility of the senior center. Words meant something. They reworded it twice, basically talking about proposed senior center. So I'm okay with that. We can entertain a motion for that, approve it now. Second one, I'm a little bit more worried. Leary on. Have we looked at this document?
No.
Yeah, I looked at it too.
I didn't.
Take it to.
See, this is all predicated on we're going to do something with this building.
Yeah.
And the fact that we're designating the basement as a senior center.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Boy, oh boy.
That's what the whole grant's about.
Yeah, that's what the grant's about.
The senior center and the basement, we talked about it, we had no problem with it. But if...
I mean, it's a struggle.
It is?
Yes.
I've been fighting it for 6 years and people bigger, tougher, and more educated than I, longer than that.
And maybe we should hold it till he's here, because yes.
He's going to make the same, and I'm all for tabling it, but he's going to make the same argument that we've already approved through that plan, the three-year
yeah.
plan that the basement was going to end. There's a grant application, I believe, in effect as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we should discuss it more. We can table it till next week.
Yeah, because it's one thing to go after it, but then if you get it, do you move forward? Is there capability of not moving forward?
100% is.
Pardon?
100% this town might not want it.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So it says we really have to be at town meeting on what are we going to do. We're as firm
and
as
I don't know if the deadlines will allow us to do that. The second one's about ADA, which basically makes us report to the disability, Office of Disability, stating that we don't have a plan in effect.
Oh, I thought we had,
was it Chris? Was his gentleman say Chris?
It's Andrew.
Andrew.
Oh, I thought it was Chris. So Chris, is it coming in?
No, it should be Andrew.
Yeah, it was Andrew that I talked to, but I think
okay.
we have to mail it back to him and to Chris, a copy of Chris too, I think. But
so Andrew's coming in?
Andrew's coming in, yes.
Yes.
Chris is probably coming too, I don't know.
Chris Dunst.
So this second one sets off flags for ADA, but speaking with Mr. Hawkins,
mm-hmm.
He's always stated that if we have a working plan in effect, which we do for ADA.
We do.
Yes.
And in fact, that was what I was going to get Steve to start to tick off on.
Just allocating the money is a huge
yes.
benefit
yeah.
to the town of Brookfield.
Right.
But this just, to me, sets off flags. This, I don't know, I'm more worried about the ADA issue than the senior center. But obviously, if it's a matching grant, we're going to be on the hook for
yeah.
matching that grant.
If we were to move forward, yeah.
yeah.
With something that the town might not even want.
Right. But then by town meeting, we need to make sure we understand.
We have to allocate money for it.
Yeah.
And I think we have to have some kind of a hearing about it.
At least.
Well, speaking with Mr. Simpson, most grants, they want money set aside, allocated prior to the application. He said we're okay with bringing it after the fact. It's a slippery slope, mm-hmm. So table this,
yeah.
have
yes.
a discussion.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
They are calling a hearing. They're coming
yeah, they
to
are.
A hearing.
So can we put it on Facebook if the Telegram Gazette would be their own article in regards to a hearing in regards to a senior center
for the basement, that'd be awesome.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Is there a detailed release you want to give me, or?
Can you put up a release?
I can email it.
Yeah, why don't you do that?
Can you give me an email address?
Thank you, sir.
What's an actual?
It is, by the way, it's posted right outside on the bulletin board, outside and inside.
But maybe better to have a nice, concise press release. Thanks, guys. Item number nine, Mr. O'Connell has graciously volunteered to put back together our CIPC. We talked about different members. The new charge, I was reading off the old one this afternoon. The new bylaw is one member of the advisory board, one member of the board of selectmen, the treasurer, one member of the Brookfield School Committee, or its designee, and three more members of the community. School committee chair has been reached out to. Treasurer, I believe, is aware. Dave, has the advisory committee been approached?
No.
All right, so we're looking for a member of the advisory board, and we're looking for a member of this board. I served on that committee for a couple of years. I think I'm done with it.
I think I was on for you myself too.
And my bandwidth is just...
So we see the problem.
Yep.
We could change it to, we'd have to go to town meeting. Because the school committee has, or its designee, we could change them all to designee, but that'd be the town meeting. But we have the three members that would like to, in the town accountant, be the ex officio member. I'm not comfortable putting a board together without a selectman, without an advisory committee, without a school committee member. I believe two, if not three, of the members in this room are here that are interested in serving on it. What do we feel?
Let's organize to organize.
That's right, okay.
And find a way to support it.
So Dave, when can you have an advisory committee member on board?
Well, I don't know. I'll bring it to them Thursday and ask them.
All right.
I've been on the committee, so I don't, you know, I'm kind of bogged down, so.
School committee, has Brian reached back out to you, or?
No, but he, I believe.
They met tonight, so I don't know.
Might be. Was it on their agenda?
I don't know. I went over there hoping to catch somebody, but they already left.
But he spoke with him about it, did you?
Yeah.
He said he would, he would wait for the selectmen to tell them that they were going to appoint the committee, and then they would designate someone of their membership.
Which I emailed back to you last week and asked you to reach out to them. Did you reach out to them?
No, I didn't, because I talked, because you said that you talked to Brian Oxman. So I just took it as a given that you asked him.
I sent in the email to you that he would be waiting on the selectmen to notify them that they should designate someone.
I think I CC'd you on my response to Karen, didn't I?
I think you did.
All right. So can you reach out to Brian and get a response from him? Once we have those members, worst case scenario, I'll volunteer to sit on the committee.
Yeah, I'll support you, Steve.
Thanks, Clarence. Thanks.
Seriously. I was going to say, is there any way that we can all take a turn going to a meeting?
No, you need some leadership. That's the time.
Okay, well, it was just a thought. If one of us really couldn't commit to it.
Hey, do you gentlemen agree that we should have those members first before we put it together?
Actually, I mean, it seems to me that they're going to designate when they designate or not. If they don't designate, the committee can still have a quorum if they choose not to participate. I guess that's up to them, but...
Well, then, but that's what we get into the fact when we had a committee that nobody was showing up to it. We couldn't meet. It became strenuous, to say the least, on just showing up to it. Kerm and I would sit in a room and say, just scratch our heads. What do we do?
Right.
And then we just said, we're done.
All I'm thinking is if you start with what you've got, with the treasurer... I think Al Jones was interested, and three others of us. Then it, and someone from the board, at least just convenes the committee, at least initially, you can start with a meeting, you can get organized. If you wait a week or two, then it just pushes the...
Well, I'm not going to lose sight of it, but I'm not going to push for it if we don't have a school committee member, if we don't have an advisory committee member, because I'll tell you what, if you don't have those two, you're not going to have a selectman on the board member.
No. But to Peter's point, as far as organizing to organize, I'd be more than happy to try to do that.
I think we should have all our pieces in place before we put the...
I think we should, too.
I agree with you.
And I commend you for wanting to do it again, Peter.
Well, I'm just imagining that if you appointed the committee tonight and then the designated members joined, you can set a meeting. You can't set a meeting until you have a committee. So it just seems like it's going to...
I'd rather wait to see if we have active participation.
Yeah, we need the advisory school.
Okay, so we'll put on next week's agenda. Hopefully Brian knows about it and brought it up at that meeting tonight. You'll bring it up Thursday night, Dan?
Yes.
And then we'll get all that together next Tuesday, because we're meeting again next week. All right, thanks, guys. We already did other correspondence. I haven't seen correspondence. I didn't even see the folder.
I went looking for it.
Is this yours? I have not read this.
Let me see if it's what I think it is.
Six-page document, so I can't speak to it.
Let me see if it's what
U.S. Department of Justice.
No, I just put it in there.
Yes, okay. This document was out in December, initially. And I think it's just more for just for benefit.
All right. So we don't have to bring it onto another agenda, so if you
want to
review it. And yeah, well, the title is Religious Land Use.
Right.
U.S. Department of
Justice. They wanted to just be clear.
Which I don't think is much of an issue in Brookfield, is it?
No, it is not.
It's not an issue like it's still not down in Brookfield.
And that's what that is. This is all
about
that.
We drove it.
The cemetery?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Any other issues before the board this evening? Hearing none, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
All right.
Thank you, everyone.